Our first speaker today is Liz Moss. Liz is a Natural Resources Extension Associate at West Virginia State University. Liz helped develop a tool for forest managers to identify pests and diseases of eastern U.S. commercial tree species and has worked extensively in invasive species education. And today, Liz will be talking us about dreamscape or nightmare on Elm Street, the importance of planting the right tree in the right place. So take it away, Liz.
Thank you, Matt. Thank you, everyone, for having me. And I kind of had a little bit of fun with this presentation since I figured it was a little quick and dirty. So this is going to be applying to all plants. I know that we're talking about plants here, but I actually have a separate presentation called There's No Such Thing as a Tree, because trees are basically just giant plants that have evolved to grow taller to reach light. So it can apply to a lot of plants. So this is actually part of a West Virginia Tree Minders series of tree care presentations that Matt will share the link for. In the state of West Virginia, we're bringing in professionals from all over the United States, but mostly West Virginia, to try to educate people and have this like urban forestry information hub on our website to guide people to correct resources. And if I could stop popping of trees in my lifetime, I will consider it a win. Anyway, let's start. I think I'm on the wrong thing here. There we go. So we want to plant a tree. We think we're ready to plant, right? Well, there's a couple of things that we need to keep in mind when we're going about planting a tree. And first of all, it has to do with not even thinking about the tree just yet. So we have a pre-planting checklist. First, we want to decide what is our objective for planting a tree. What function is it going to serve for us? Because trees can serve a lot of functions. And then we're going to be doing our site assessment. This looking at the actual place where we're going to be planting the tree. We're looking at above and below ground space, and all of this is going to be interconnected because nobody exists on an island in nature. We're looking at soil volume and quality. We're going to be considering light and exposure conditions on our site, and that includes wind, things like that. Obviously, water. Water is always going to be a priority there. And then microclimate considerations. I mentioned wind, and there's a couple of other things that you can keep in mind, like frost pockets, wind tunnels, re-reflected heat, things like that. I'll talk about that. And then we're going to be trying to choose the right tree to match that site. Because in my experience as an urban forester, I found that a lot of people see this beautiful little maple tree and it's so pretty and it's a little 5-gallon bucket at the nursery. And they think, oh, this would look great in my yard, but they don't think about the 50-pound bag of dog food they have to buy every week to keep it fed. So just keeping in mind that trees live a long time. And some of them can get quite large. We need to do our research. We want to take care of this thing before it becomes a huge problem, basically. So why are we planting a tree? There's lots of reasons to plant a tree. I can always come up with some reason. Are we looking for aesthetics? So aesthetics is referring to perhaps like adding curbside appeal to your property. You might want some flowers. You might want winter interest, shedding bark, things like that. Also, making our lot look better, maybe our communities, our streets. Large, healthy trees increase property values, and ornamental trees are just aesthetically pleasing. Are we thinking about energy saving? We want to shade our house. A properly placed tree on the southwest or western side of your house can help cut down on air conditioning bills in the summer, especially if it's deciduous, because then in the winter, those leaves fall off, and it's letting through that winter sun to help warm your house, and thus cutting down a little bit on your heating bill. That's actually my old house that I used to live in, and the master bedroom that the tree shaded stayed considerably cooler than the other side, my poor kid's room that baked in the afternoon sun. Do we want our tree for privacy? Evergreen trees planted can cut down on both noise, pollution, and can block your neighbor's view or a terrible view if you need to. Can give you a little bit of privacy. Are we looking to attract wildlife? We can get some of these, all of these things from a tree if we look for the right tree. Do you want to deal with fruit? Do you want to deal with wildlife leavings? So you have to think about all these things when we're going about picking the right tree or why we want to plant a tree. So form follows function. And I like to tell people, this little thing stick in my head, like ornamental trees are like the dog species of the plant world. You can get them in any shape, color, size that you want. They're like the teacup chihuahua of the plant world. So there's a tree for every site. You know, you can get weeping forms. You can get forms that stand more upright. You might want to think about whether you want the tree to spread and give you more shade. Maybe you need a small tree for a small space. There's something for everybody. A couple of examples of some fastidiata forms or fastidiate forms, ones that are going to grow tall and slender. So if you want an oak, you can get a pin oak that stands in like a column. You can do your research and find out what you need. So selecting the right form or shape to complement the desired function that you want the tree to serve can significantly reduce your maintenance and costs over time and also increase the tree's value in the landscape. So we're thinking ahead, we're planning ahead. So now into site assessment. The first thing you can think about is your hardiness zone. New York gets kind of cold. I have family up there. So that can kind of cut down on the species of trees that might work for your site. And we're not planting subtropical trees in many parts of West Virginia or New York. So start with that. Think about your light exposure. How many hours of sunlight does your site get? Because some trees need full 6+ hours a day. Some trees can handle 3 to 6 hours a day, which is considered your partial sun, partial shade. And then shade is less than 3 hours a day. So you have to keep that in mind. Some may tolerate more sun. If you have a flowering tree or a fruiting tree, you're going to need a lot more sun. Microclimate. Are you located on a hillside? We're thinking about elevation too, because that adds to microclimate. Thinking about reflected heat. Is your site next to like in a parking lot? Is it a parking lot island? A maple won't handle that very well because it'll be cooked basically. To think about trees that can handle that specific microclimate. We're thinking about whether your streets or your sidewalks where your site is get any kind of salt spray, whether that be from salting sidewalks or even from coastal winds with salt spray. All of these things you need to think about. And then of course, last but definitely not least, above ground space. You have to think about whether you need to have a tree that you're gonna have to raise so often so that people don't get poked in the eyeball by the lower branches. I have a couple of maples outside my office that I have to raise every year because even after it rains, they droop. So just thinking about your future maintenance, traffic, usage patterns of your site, all of that. Very basic stuff that a lot of people just don't think about. Below ground, we're also thinking about space. We're thinking about rooting space because there's actual debate going on Reddit, whether a tree is a below ground organism that uses a snorkel to live above ground, or if a tree is a below ground organism that, below ground is an organism that uses a snorkel to breathe above ground, or if it's an above ground creature that uses a straw or its roots to live below ground. Well, if you think about it, if you cut a tree off, the top half's not going to live. The roots can re-sprout. The soil is like the biggest thing for a tree, especially space. And that rooting space. So we're thinking about not just like a tree pit where a tree just basically has a column of soil. It needs space to spread out. A tree roots spread out in an open grown form 2 to 3 times the width of the canopy, if it's possible. So they're gonna cause some infrastructure damage. You have to think about utilities underground too. A simple thing is just to call 811. Every state has it. Just call them, see where your water lines are so that you don't destroy them with your tree. Not fun. And then we're thinking about, what is the soil made of? Does it have a lot of traffic? Is it compacted? Is it a really heavy clay soil? Is it really alkaline or really acidic? Because pH can affect the nutrients that are available to a tree. So And then drainage, of course, too. You can do a simple percolation test where you just dig a hole and fill it with water and measure how fast it drains. You can find that online. So just very simple things like that, because you can change certain aspects of soil, but things like texture and drainage are kind of hard to work with. But something as simple as like a layer of mulch can go a long way for your backyard tree or even your street tree. And I always talk to people about amending soils. When you plant a tree, don't amend the soil that's going back into the hole with the tree, because it's like putting a mini fridge in your bedroom. You don't ever find the need to go down into the kitchen and make yourself some food when you have it right there in your bedroom. So the same thing with the tree. You want to encourage it to grow in the native soil and seek out what it needs. So now we've done a site assessment. We're thinking, okay, I got a good idea of this. Now we're going to choose the right tree. So we have to keep certain things in mind for our tree. We have to consider the mature size and also the longevity. This particular tree is beautiful, but as it gets larger, it's going to probably grow directly into that building. And at this point, it's probably already affecting the foundation of that building with its roots. I have to think about how long the tree is going to live. How big is it going to get? How much work do I have to put into this thing? To think about maintenance requirements. Do you want to deal with messy fruit, seed pods, leaves? This is my husband trying to rake that same tree in our old house, and my children would just jump into the piles and re-scatter them. You have to think about whether you need to prune that tree to maintain the shape that you want. If it's multi-stemmed and it tends to grow a lot of lower branches, like say a young river birch, you're going to have to prune that thing over time. Native versus exotic. Not all exotics are bad. You just have to make sure that they're not invasive. And the definition of an invasive species is a non-native or alien to the ecosystem, and also causes or is likely to cause economic or environmental harm or harm to human health. So basically, it's an exotic that's gotten out of control and it's not letting the natives kind of find their own space. It's just taking over everything. So things like your tree of heaven, your royal polonia, and even some like crepe myrtles. So with woody species, it takes them a little bit of time to get established and start to reproduce. So we're seeing trees that have been planted in the past starting to become invasive now because it's taken them so long to naturalize and become invasive. But there are certain species like your Chinese elm, things like that, that are already spreading, and you find seedlings absolutely everywhere. So keep that in mind. Try to stick with natives, exhaust all possibilities with natives, and go for like local progeny. So a tree that's been grown in your region. Because an oak that was grown in, say, Oregon might not do well in, you know, it could be native to New York. But if it's grown in Oregon, grew up in Oregon, might not do so great in the climate here in New York. That kind of thing. Think about what your neighbors are planting, or what's already in the city if you're on a tree board. If everybody's planting maples or dogwoods, maybe you go with an oak instead or a redwood, because this is, and I think this is either New York or New Jersey. These were all a bunch of maples that is a residential street that had to be removed because of Asian longhorn beetle. So going back to that IPM, thinking ahead and planning for any kind of local pest or disease or even invasive pest or disease, things to keep in mind. And you can get a lot of resistant species to a lot of diseases. You can do research on that too. Dogwoods that are resistant to anthracnose, honey locusts that are resistant to honey locust spider mite, things like that. There are so many options out there. So make sure you're making a wise investment. And that's all I have for today, guys. I try to keep it pretty short and creepy. Did anybody have any questions? Because I was just kind of barreling through there.
Thank you, Liz. I'm not seeing any questions in the chat yet. People are probably processing the information, so I'm going to ask my question.
Okay.
First, you gave us a lot of great information to consider, but I'm wondering what is the number one issue that you see people, or the number one mistake that you see people making with the right plant, right place? Is it sunlight? Is it the soil quality? Is it
mature size.
The mature size.
Yes, absolutely. So I see a lot of top trees in West Virginia, especially even when there's no utilities around. Somebody plants a tree and they're like, oh, and it's usually an older person that just maybe have learned that from their grandparents or what have you. And they're like, oh, it just got too big. And I'm like, well, that's great. You can do what's called a reduction cut. But it's also a cost thing. So they'll hire any gym bob with a chainsaw who's just like, oh, yeah, I'll just top that off for you. So that's what I run into a lot.
And are there resources? We shared your website. Are there other resources that people can go to kind of find very easily what the mature size of the tree is going to be so that they can pick the right tree for that location?
Well, there are a lot of, and I would go with extension publications because they're research-based. There's a ton of resources out there that will give you information on mature size of tree of certain species. And then also just the tag on a tree at the nursery or talk to the nursery owner, and it'll give you an idea of mature size and spread, even hardiness zones. And what was the other part of that question? Sorry.
Just resources to find the right
Yes.
tree height. So I think you addressed it.
Yeah, absolutely. And then this tree minders program, it's West Virginia tree minders, but it's got literally everything. We have three paths of instruction. Path one is for just everybody, and it's literally basics of like tree biology 101, urban forestry 101, how to prune a tree, all of it, how to plant a tree, how to select the right tree, all of it. And it's all online modules that you can watch on your own. And then there's like a little quiz, and we're trying to get it to a point where it's like a master gardener for trees. Still working on that, but it's considered a certification program here in West Virginia. We're just getting the ball rolling on it. And then it came about as an opportunity for people to learn on their own. And then when they come to technical service providers like myself, there's so few of us in the state available to the public that we wanted to concentrate on hands-on in-person workshops. So people get the knowledge online, they find out about workshops in their area, they come to us. And so that way they cement that knowledge that they've already gained online, but anybody can access this. And I see that somebody mentored or master naturalist training, absolutely. The best way to support a young sapling, oh, sorry, first, what organic material to add to soil when planting a new peach tree? I always recommend if you're going to amend soil and you're thinking about like an orchard type thing, do the whole site. So if you want to add manure, fill up the whole site. If you're talking about just one tree, you can do just plant the tree in the native soil, and then mulch. The hardwood mulch, you can get it for free from like we have Asplund, like any tree care company. And there's no proof that it necessarily conducts any kind of fungal pathogens. Now, if it came from an absolutely sick tree, like another peach, I would not use it. But typically, it's pretty safe. It's better if it's composted a little bit. So get a whole load delivered and then use it over time. And as it breaks down, it adds organic layers, organic matter to the soil, helps decompress the soil or decompact the soil, keeps down on weeds, and also regulates soil moisture and soil temperature. So mulch, mulch, mulch. I'm always talking about that. And don't pile it against the trunk. And what's the best time of year to remove a seedling already growing on the property to a more appropriate site? So, moving seedlings, I would wait until it's completely dormant and before leaf out, before the buds start to swell on a tree. So, in West Virginia, that's about late February. Probably for you guys, it's more like late March, I imagine. But who knows now, it's getting warmer. I would wait for it to be completely dormant and then scoop up as much of that root system as you can. Get it well established in the soil before it starts to leaf out. And you might need to possibly give it a lot more TLC that following growing season. Definitely water, maybe even a possible what's it called? Fertilome root stimulator, phosphorus stimulates root growth. So but I would give it that first year, just kind of establish, make sure it's nice and watered and has mulch, and just baby it.
So I think that's a great segue to our next presenter.
Yeah.
So thank you, Liz, for your excellent information. There were a bunch of other questions that came
in. I'm just going to answer them in chat. Is that okay?
That's perfect. Thank you so much. So I'll ask you to stop sharing, which you did, and Jen can pull up her screen. Our next speaker is for an IP a minute, which takes a quick look at a timely topic. And as we've just been discussing, that is transplanting trees and shrubs. Our speaker today is Jen Lerner, who's a senior resource educator for Cornell Cooperative Extension in Putnam County, New York. Jen wears many hats and provides education on a wide variety of topics. I'm a resident of Putnam County and I see Jen everywhere I go. So I don't know how she does it. She's very busy, but she does a great job. And today she's talking about transplanting trees and shrubs. So take it away, Jen.
Thanks, Matt. And thanks, Liz. That's awesome stuff. We're gonna touch a little bit on what Liz said and then expand too as well on some of those topics. All right. So some experts say that 80% of our landscape tree problems originate below ground, which is exactly where we can't see them. And it's usually us humans that cause the problems in the first place. So let's do a little bit of a deeper dive down into the rooting zone. So, you know, when we just talked, Liz covered choosing the right plant for the right site conditions. That's certainly a really important part of it. But in these next 5 minutes, we're just going to touch on some tools for planting success. Each one of them deserves its own deep dive, but let's get into the root of transplanting trees and shrubs. Well, there's a lot to unpack in these two images, and you might have heard the term pot-bound or root-bound, and this can refer to a root system that has grown too long in a pot, and the roots begin to circle the pot in their search for additional resources. So a similar effect, though, can happen when a planting hole is cut into compacted soil or a textural boundary or difference occurs between the backfill and the native soil. So Liz was talking before about using the native soil to backfill. Don't amend it very much or at all. But there's also a little bit more in the photo on the left I'd like you to take a look at. If you look at that trunk of that sad tree there, where do the roots come out of the trunk? That area where it kind of gets wider is called the root flare. And in this case, the root flare was deeply buried and then covered again with mulch. And that kind of hairy root system at the top or adventitious roots, those grew out above the root flare, and that causes a host of problems. So in transplanting, one of which can be girdling roots. So let's take a look at girdling roots as well. Well, as both the tree trunk and the roots grow and expand, those adventitious roots that we initially saw in that other photograph will kind of start to argue with each other. And as the tree expands, the root expands, it becomes a girdling root. So choosing the right planting depth is essential in successfully planting your tree or shrub, but that's not as easy as it sounds sometimes. Well, to choose the right depth, you've got to poke around and see where that root flare is. And one of the links we provided or can provide for you is a link to finding, how do you find the root flare? What does it look like? And the root flare will be your guide. With bare root trees, it's very evident. You can see where the root flare is. But with bald and burlapped or container grown trees, it's not always evident. So you may have to gently remove some soil to see, and definitely peel back and remove the burlap to check where the root flare is. Now, there was a question in the chat about, you know, do you remove the burlap? Yes, you definitely remove the burlap. And often that depends on the site and where you've gotten the tree to. You might do that right in the planting hole. That root flare, though, is going to be your guide. You want to plant the tree in an ample hole where the base has been compacted to prevent settling. And that large root ball will settle over time. It's a big, heavy root ball. So it's kind of pancake outward. So we often say for the larger root balls, plant with 1 or 2 inches of the soil higher than the surrounding grade. And if the drainage is a problem, you would plant at even a higher height. So to give you an idea of what that might look like, here you'll see on the right a diagram, a little bit out of focus, but I think you can get the idea. that you have some planting options. And in all of these, note how the backfill that is added there kind of feathers out above the original grade and feathers out wide into the planting situation. This gives room for the roots to find their happy place. They can grow outward, especially if that soil is compacted. So that's just something to think about when you're planting a little bit high. But it's not just the depth of the hole, it's also the width of the hole. So the more compacted the soil, the bigger you've got to think. Avoid creating a textural boundary, where we said earlier. And if you've got to do some amending because the soil is really that big, think of a site-wide amendment, like Liz was saying, a widespread site amendment. It doesn't sound like a lot of fun because you know it's backbreaking and there's a lot to carry there. There's a lot of soil. But whenever possible, use the native soil as backfill. So thinking back, you all heard a lot about mulch volcanoes, I'm sure, but thinking back to those adventitious roots, look at this picture with fresh eyes. And in a little drawing on the right, look at the adventitious roots and imagine them growing out of the trunk. They'll be forced to grow around in circles in that mulch volcano. And that will increase the chance for them to, in the future, become girdling roots. But those roots will also be exposed to more extremes of weather than the roots that are going to be growing down in the ground, tucked away safely in the soil. So when we talk about mulching, we want to keep the mulch flat. Think of a pancake or a lunar volcano, you know, that nice flat, versus Mount Vesuvius cupping up around the tree. And then almost lastly, somebody asked about staking. And staking is really one of those things that has come and gone and back again. There's a lot of arguments about it. Staking is not always needed, but in certain situations, the benefit of staking can outweigh the risks. So if it's a really windy site, you might want to stake, and there's a lot of different options for staking. Or if vandalism is a problem, if people are just gonna walk along and yank things out of the ground just for the fun of yanking them out of the ground, a stake can be a very good deterrent. But importantly, remove that stake as soon as it is not needed. Don't leave it there indefinitely, because a tree learns from the wind. You know, it needs to have that movement to do it, to really grow strong. So, and it could also girdle the tree higher up. And then lastly, I just want to talk about irrigation. Plants that are irrigated establish more quickly. It's less stress for the plant. Consider that root ball and the backfill. They might absorb water differently if the soil is amended. So again, native soil to backfill. And then, is the underlying drainage necessary? You might have to plant higher if it's a poor drainage situation. Then don't forget to monitor your trees and shrubs once they're installed. They are living things and they are not a set it and forget it. Check to see when you need to remove that stake if you've got stakes. Check to see if you still need to use irrigation. Those gator bags like this are very handy for trees, where especially if you can't get to them with a hose to fill very often. So just in review, in that 5-minute pass through, everything you need to know about planting a tree correctly. Obviously, choose the right plant for the right site conditions. Don't plant them too deeply. I know it almost sounds counterintuitive, but don't plant them too deeply. Give roots room to spread out by creating a wider planting hole. And don't create a textural boundary by adding a backfill or unusual fill into the hole. Use the native soil that's there as much as appropriate. Mulch shallow, wide, and don't touch the trunk with the mulch if you can. Try to keep it away from the trunk. Plan for watering, and above all, don't just leave it out there to take care of itself. Check those trees and shrubs and make sure they're getting what they need. That was 5 minutes.
Great. Well, thank you, Jen. And thank you, Liz, for two great presentations. We're at our time for today. So I just wanted to remind everyone that we'll take your questions and we will answer them in the description of the YouTube video. Please tune in next month for our discussion on jumping worms and roof gutter pests. Joellen had mentioned in the chat that jumping worms can be a problem when we're transplanting potted plants if that stock contains those pests. So thank you. Have a great long weekend, and we'll see you next month.